whenever I'm in the area of Arnhem, I used to come to this place here and to have a look. And this affects me much more.
The laddie beside me suddenly disappeared, and when I looked round, he was lying on his back with a hole through the tip of the middle of his head.
The feeling was there, we're doomed.
It was ambitious and it was a risk, but it was worth it.
It was the last German victory.
Monte Cassino, Normandy, El Alamein, among the most epic conflicts of all time. The Ardennes, Dunkirk. In World War II Revisited, we go back with the soldiers who fought on both sides of those battles. Men who, 60 years ago, were implacable enemies, meet now, sometimes for the first time, at the scenes of some of the most crucial battles of the Second World War. In this program, a Polish veteran and an old German soldier come face to face in the Dutch town of Arnhem, where so many died in the disastrous battle during September 1944, but where they survived.
I told you that I have been in Russia.
Yes, of course.
And here, this fight in Arnhem was a very intensive one. It was lasting from the morning till to the next morning.
Yes.
Always fighting, even through the night.
Yes.
This is the scene of one of the most infamous and controversial military operations of the Second World War. Here, at Arnhem in Holland, a bold attempt was made by the Allies to finish the war early by combining a ground offensive with the biggest landing of airborne troops ever seen. The operation failed, not only because crucial errors were made at the planning stage, but also because vital intelligence that warned of the strength of the German forces in the area was ignored. As a result, some 8,000 Allied troops were killed, wounded, or captured during the doomed operation. In the late summer of 1944, Germany was in full retreat on the Western Front. Normandy had been conquered, Paris had been liberated, and Hitler's downfall seemed certain. But by early September, because of strong German resistance along the Reich's western frontier, the famous Siegfried Line, the Allied offensive had stalled. A plan was now needed to break the deadlock, and Field Marshal Montgomery believed he had the best solution. His radical strategy called for a British corps of troops to sweep upwards from the Dutch border into occupied territory just west of the Siegfried Line, bypassing the so-called West Wall. They could then turn right to attack the heartland of Germany itself. Montgomery planned that three further divisions would support the troops fighting on the ground. These would arrive simultaneously from the air and secure a corridor through which the ground corps could advance in safety. This airborne attack by almost 35,000 men would be named Operation Market. At the same time, Lieutenant General Brian Horrocks would lead his 30 Corps north in an operation that would be codenamed Garden. The entire ambitious enterprise was therefore codenamed Operation Market Garden. If Montgomery's bold strategy did succeed, a speedy end to the war was in sight, perhaps even by Christmas 1944. Despite the doubts and disagreements amongst senior Allied figures, the lure of the final prize proved too great to resist, and the Supreme Commander of Allied Forces, General Eisenhower, approved Montgomery's plan on September the 10th. On that same day, the British Armoured Guards Division captured this canal bridge near to the Belgium-Holland border. Known as Joe's Bridge, it would be the starting point for Market Garden just 7 days later. The bridges within the land corridor were the key to Market Garden. The task of capturing these five strategically vital targets was given to the three airborne divisions. The American 101st Airborne Division's mission was to take the Wilhelmina and Zuid-Willemsvaart canal bridges. Further north, the 82nd Airborne Division were to seize the river bridges at Grave and at Nijmegen. The final bridge would be the responsibility of Major General Roy Urquhart and the newly formed 1st Airborne Corps. Their target was the bridge at Arnhem. Since their success on D-Day, British airborne troops had been eager to get back into action. But the rapid advances by Allied ground forces had put a halt to all subsequent missions so far.
Sometimes we got to the stage of some being in the air. We certainly all got to the stage where we were on the drone ready to get into a glider. It was cancelled. So when Arnhem turned up, we said, hooray.
I think everyone was quite happy and very, very confident. Overconfident, I possibly... going in.
The flaws in the battle plan that had so concerned some of the Allied commanders were to have fatal consequences. A shortage of transport aircraft meant that the 1st Airborne Corps were to be deployed over three successive days, taking away completely the crucial element of surprise. Another potential problem was the proposed landing site, which was 8 miles away from the objective.
First of all, the airmen would not take us close to the bridge because of flak. Intelligence reports said the flak was pretty heavy. They also didn't want to land gliders in the polar fields around the bridge because they said it was unsuitable. And so we had to go for places where gliders could land, and parachutists. You didn't want to land them in the middle of woods. You didn't want the gliders to land in woods. And so we were 8 to 10 miles out.
General Sosabowski, our commanding, said that the air operation, the parachute operation, is not like buying something for installments. It must be done unexpectedly and, of course, in force, concentrated, dropped straight on the target, and not having to, in our case, we had to march about 4.5 to 5 miles after we landed.
Morale actually was high, and most men, I think, were optimistic. Wise heads, I had one older soldier in my own signal unit who said to me quietly, "We are for it this time."
On the 16th and 17th of September, more than 1,000 Allied aircraft bombed the German defences in Holland in preparation for the attack. Meanwhile, back in England, 22 airfields were a frenzy of activity as the American and British troops bound for Arnhem boarded their planes and gliders. At 9:30 a.m. on Sunday the 17th of September, the greatest airborne armada of the Second World War, took off. Nearly 60 years on from these momentous events, we took Alan Makovac, who was the artillery liaison officer in the Polish brigade, back to the battlefield to meet Siegfried Geiser, a former German tank commander. They met outside the Hartenstein Hotel in Oesterbeek, now an airborne museum, but which served as British 1st Airborne Division's headquarters during the battle.
Oh, hello.
So, hello, Alan. Nice
How
to
are
meet you.
You. Fine. Nice to meet you.
Yeah. I'm very happy that we didn't kill each other.
Well, yeah. Ditto.
Yeah.
We both entered into the battle on the 18th of September. This was the second day of the Battle of Arnhem. He came here with a glider and me on a tank.
One of the emotions as you were in the air when you looked at the line, a beautiful group of gliders, hundreds of them. It was a wonderful scene.
For the Allies, the operation began well, as in the early afternoon, the gliders began to land and the paratroopers began to descend into their strategic drop zones. Ans Kramer was just 12 years old when she witnessed this remarkable sight from the garden of her parents' house in Oesterbeek, 3 miles west of Arnhem.
All of a sudden, we saw the parachutists coming down. That's a lovely sight. It was some villages away, but we could see it over the top of the trees, and the colors of the parachutes and the sunshine. And so all of a sudden, it was one big feast. We were going to be free, and the British were coming.
The people here from the houses along this road, or wherever we moved, they were coming out with flowers. They were coming out with a cup of tea and sandwiches and giving out some refreshments.
Because they thought the war is over now.
Well,
the British are here. The war is over.
Absolutely, yeah, quite right, yes.
I landed with the rest of the gliders on the first day. I landed exactly where I was supposed to land, and that was beside the lunatic asylum.
There were distressing scenes when the asylum near Wolfhetzer was hit by Allied bombs, and a number of the bewildered inmates wandered out of its ruins.
These unfortunate inmates followed us for a considerable distance. You know their appearance on camp, uncoordinated in their appearance, laughing, joking, making funny gestures. Incidentally, I could hear our battalion comedian, a very good soldier named Jock Greer, and I could make him, I could hear him behind me making a good, strong, logical case that they were the wise men and we were the idiots.
After the break, we'll see how the disaster of Operation Market Garden gradually unfolded. At 2 p.m. on the 17th of September, Lieutenant General Brian Horrocks ordered an enormous artillery barrage at Joe's Bridge. At 2:35, the tanks of the Armoured Guards Division, supported by infantry, began their perilous 60-mile journey north towards Arnhem Bridge. Ahead of them, the American troops of 101st Airborne Division were quickly into action, capturing the Zuid-Willemsvaart Canal Bridge and forcing the Germans to demolish the nearby Wilhelmina Bridge at Sens. Meanwhile, 82nd Airborne captured the Grave Road Bridge and now were preparing to take the giant bridge over the Waal at Nijmegen. However, further north still, near Arnhem, the British 1st Airborne Division learned of the loss of several gliders that had contained precious motor vehicles. This would slow their advance towards Arnhem Bridge. To add to their troubles, it was discovered that there were serious faults with the radio equipment.
Mine did work. Mine worked on the DZ, calling, reporting when we were ready to move off. It worked several times the next day, and after that, fruitless, it was out.
Right at the last minute, an American team was brought in with us with a wireless suitable for calling for air support. And it wasn't until midnight that they'd seen their sets for the first time. They didn't know them. And sadly, they didn't work the other end. They got damaged. And so we had no communications for air support.
Everything was very unfortunate, even the choice of the wave band. And the one we were on was so close to a high-powered local German station that you could barely discern.
This is the Hartenstein Hotel in Oesterbeek, just 3 miles west of Arnhem Bridge. Hurriedly abandoned by Field Marshal Walter Model when the Allies landed, it became the headquarters of the 1st Airborne Division until September the 25th. Here, the British commanders found the true nature of the task before them. Arnhem was not as lightly defended as had been promised. Just a few miles to the north and east of the Arnhem area were the battle-hardened troops of the 9th and 10th SS Panzer Divisions. Dutch intelligence had warned the British that panzers were situated in the Arnhem region, but their warnings were ignored, with dreadful consequences for the British troops. Within 3 hours of the British landings, the Germans had their defensive strategy in place. The 9th Panzer Division was sent towards Arnhem, and the 10th towards Nijmegen. Troops already in the Arnhem area were put on full battle alert, and reinforcements were being brought in from other parts of the Netherlands. Among these was Siegfried Geiser's tank unit.
We were stationed at the airport of Delft. This was a small airport at that time, where we reached the message that there was an airborne landing in Arnhem. And the same night, we drove with our tanks from Delft to Arnhem.
Completely unaware of the true strength of their enemy, the 1st Parachute Brigade set off towards Arnhem Bridge just before 4 o'clock. In command was Brigadier Lathbury with his divisional commander, Roy Urquhart. Three battalions of the parachute regiment took three separate routes, and it was vital that they advanced at high speed. North of Wolfhetzer, 1st Battalion soon discovered the true strength of the German defences. Faced with a hail of shot and shell, they were forced to halt in nearby woods. There was no chance of them reaching the bridge that day. To the south, the 3rd Battalion also met fierce German fire, and it too was forced to halt, although they did kill Arnhem's German commandant, General Kusen. Alan Makovac remembers walking past this very scene.
We found a German car stationed just about maybe 15, 20 yards from this road here, that we can see the cars now going now. And there it was. The driver killed, and also we recognized the officer who was in the car, with the legs still in, but he was lying already, his back on the ground. It was General Kusin, we learned later on.
12-year-old Ants Kramer and her parents could hear the sound of battle in the distance and had seen troops passing their house at Oesterbeek on their way to Arnhem, only to see them return a little later.
My mother went to the street and said very softly, "Are you British?" And they said, "Yes." So she said, "Why are you going back?" And they said, "We are too early. The Germans are still asleep." We found out afterwards they couldn't pass, they couldn't go on, so they had to go back.
Only the 2nd Battalion was able to make any headway during the confused and bloody fighting in the streets of Arnhem. They took the southernmost route to Arnhem Bridge, near the lower Rhine River. In command was Lieutenant Colonel John Frost, one of the most respected paratroopers in the British Army. Unfortunately for Frost, the Germans blew up the Arnhem Railway Bridge before it could be taken. But by 8 o'clock, two para had arrived at the northern end of the road bridge. They were, however, completely cut off from their comrades. The following morning, September the 18th, the Germans attacked. Two para continued to hold their position at the bridge with a force of some 500 men, but German artillery was taking a dreadful toll. Amid the most appalling carnage and destruction, Frost's men hung on grimly as desperate attempts were made to reach them by the 1st and 3rd Battalion. To make matters worse, Brigadier Lathbury was seriously injured by a sniper's bullet. He was later to be taken prisoner. And General Urquhart was forced to hide in the attic of this house in Oosterbeek for the whole day, unable to contact his comrades on the faulty British radio sets. At the divisional headquarters, near to the landing zones, Brigadier Hicks assumed command in the absence of General Urquhart. Hicks was commander of the Air Landing Brigade, which comprised the three other British battalions dropped on the first day. Hicks could do little to relieve Frost and two para at the bridge, but the new commander knew that reinforcements were due to arrive that day, with the Poles to follow 24 hours later. Now, another disaster struck. The Germans had found a copy of the orders for Market Garden aboard a shot-down US Waco glider. They now had every detail of the Allied plans for the battle in their possession.
It did have a slight effect because it gave them details of the second lift coming in, and they were due to come in the morning, but thick fog in England stopped them, delayed them by 5 hours, and the Messerschmitts, which arrived in the morning to shoot them up. Of course, all they could do was to shoot up the empty gliders on the landing zone.
The landing went very smooth. There was fighting going on around the perimeter. The Germans had reacted to the first day's landing. They did know what was going on.
When we came towards the landing here, where we are today, we came from that direction towards here, and we already began to see the anti-aircraft artillery in action.
We had a distant view of one of our aircraft being hit just short of the landing zone and plummeting to earth. I knew quite well that a considerable number of my former comrades unfortunately went down with it.
As we were unloading, there were machine guns on the edge of this forest wood here, and we just rushed like hell to get away from the sort of fire line.
After Siegfried Geyser's arrival at Arnhem from Delft, nearly 100 miles away, his first task was to try and stop the second air landing by the Allies.
There were still some gliders which landed, and we saw them on a distance of about 200 or 300 meters, and some of the parachutes landed very near to us, and they were very surprised to find there German tanks. I remember there was 2 or 3 gliders who had already landed, and the soldiers were coming out of the glider, and we just were firing with our gun to the glider.
It was on his way back from this action that Siegfried ran into trouble in the suburbs around Oosterbeek.
When we came to this point, just round the corner, there was a British anti-tank gun, which stopped us. Our tank started to burn. My crew, we were four persons, we escaped, we came out very safely, and then there was still some shrapnel fire, and my driver and me, we got a little bit wounded with some piece of metal in my leg, and it was not too hard. Next day I could walk, and next day I went in another tank.
Early in the morning of September the 19th, 1st and 3rd Battalion made a final desperate attempt to reach their beleaguered colleagues at the bridge, moving along the lower Rhine, using the morning fog as cover. When it lifted, they were exposed to massive German fire from both north and south, and the two battalions were virtually wiped out. To the north, 4th Brigade also suffered terrible casualties around the railway line.
The sheer volume of the German fire shook me. To cheer myself up, spoke to a signaler, a dependable lad, London lad, called Ted Garlin. You could view the place looked like hell, and I said, I think I can hear our Bren still going ahead, ascending the slope. His reply was, "Don't talk rot, Harry. Our chaps are simply being hammered."
Alan Makovac, who was still waiting for the arrival of his Polish comrades, helped the British troops root out German snipers from the houses in Oosterbeek.
When I got to the back door there, it was open, but the staircase going upstairs, up there. I took off my belt one of the hand grenades. I pulled out the pin, and when I sort of got up the top, I just said, open the door, bang there, shut the door, took the cover, wah! I opened the door, and she was down there. I just wondered, shall I sort of use the and help him, you see, to die quicker. He was bleeding badly. And I said, what shall I do? But because we already knew ammunition supply, food supply was already cut off at the time, I thought, well, I better keep my bullet, you see, for another occasion in self-defense.
With British troops holding back attacks on all fronts, there was only one bit of good news for them. Roy Urquhart, their commander, had escaped his hiding place and had made a speedy return to his headquarters at the Hartenstein Hotel in Oosterbeek. Here he learnt the crushing news that the Germans had overrun the British dropping zones.
We could never talk to the resupply aircraft. This was put right for the Rhine crossing, but with us, we could not talk to the aircraft. So we couldn't tell them to drop elsewhere. We tried everything with yellow flags and what have you, and so only a small proportion got to us.
We had the bitter experience of watching the intense bravery of those pilots and those dispatchers dropping supplies that by ill fortune were fated to land in possession of the Germans.
When the bombs came down for the supply for the British soldiers, we got some of them because the ammunition we couldn't use because we had different weapons. And some of the bombs included some cigarettes and chocolate and very fine food. It tastes very well, but you know, we hadn't had chocolate for a long time. So it was a big surprise for us.
Well, do you know why you didn't see those in Germany? Because when in England they were producing the boxes of chocolates, you see, in Germany, they were producing tanks instead and the guns, you see. That's why you didn't see them. You were not equipped, you see.
But you were producing tanks too.
Well,
and you were producing gliders.
The British troops did manage to recover some supplies, but they were not always what they expected.
They dropped these cases full of odd, what we thought would be our life-saving. I managed to get one one day and pull it back to our trench, and when we opened the damn thing, it was full of red berries.
They were still working on Plan A, which was to invade Germany. And after the fifth and sixth days, they were still dropping berries and cap badges for the grand triumphal entry into Germany.
Join us after the break when we'll see how Arnhem became a bridge too far. On Wednesday, September the 20th, the German shells continued to rain down on Two Paras' position at Arnhem Bridge. And on the morning of Thursday, September the 21st, the Germans launched their final assault. By midday, both sides of Arnhem Bridge were in German hands. Despite the incredible bravery of John Frost and his men, it really had been a bridge too far. Meanwhile, to the south, the American airborne forces had their target bridges, including the mighty road bridge at Nijmegen. The British armour spearhead of 30 Corps that had fought so hard to get to Nijmegen crossed the bridge at 6 o'clock on that day. They were now just 10 miles from Arnhem. News of the capture of Nijmegen Bridge certainly boosted the morale of Urquhart and his surviving troops, who had now formed themselves into a pocket at Oosterbeek, to the west of Arnhem. With radio contact at last established with 30 Corps, British heavy artillery fire could now shell the encircling Germans to the north.
They got to Nijmegen, which was, what, 10 to 12 miles away. They started firing, supporting us, on the southern side of the Waal at Nijmegen, but then they found the targets we gave them. Some of them were out of range. So the next morning, they came to the other side. And it was very heavy firepower they could give us.
Alan Makovac, the Polish artillery liaison officer, was one of the spotters for these guns up in the church tower at Oosterbeek.
That is the window you see, of course, from which I have been watching, you see, observing, you see, myself and the English officer from the 1st Artillery Regiment of the division. Both of us were in the tower. Unfortunately, we were shot down. There was a direct hit. Part of it, you see, collapsed. You see, we landed down here on the ground here. And of course, my colleague was moaning, you see, helping, you see, to sort of be assisted immediately. So all I could do to him, seeing a lot of pouring blood from his stomach area through his clothing, to give him morphine injection to ease his pain. There were sort of medics here who were attending some wounded soldiers, and they gave us the first aid.
It wasn't just the soldiers that were suffering. Caught in between the fierce fighting were the civilians of Arnhem and Oosterbeek.
We were finished up actually in the houses of Oosterbeek, where I must say the occupants of those houses and the natives of Oosterbeek were absolutely marvellous, despite the fact that we were ruining their village.
It was a mess outside. Trees were over the street. The veranda were shot away and were lying in the street. There were dead horses, there were dead soldiers.
As the action was getting potentially more and more dangerous, I was only heartbroken to see that some of these wonderful people were killed, wounded, or had to leave their house.
My mother went to an old German because the young ones were very angry. And this was a man in his 60s. And she went up to him and she asked him what we should do. And he said, "My brother soldiers are not very happy about the civilians, how they behaved and helped the British. And they are very trigger happy. I can advise you to get out." And we did.
I can understand that those people here were very much against the German. And this we had to accept, and we couldn't change the situation.
On the 21st of September, the 1st Polish Paratroop Brigade, commanded by Major General Stanislaw Sosabowski, finally arrived. They'd been delayed in Britain by the poor weather for 2 days, but they now faced a baptism of fire.
We beheld the Polish brigade coming in to land, and we were in no position. We could not give them adequate protecting fire. It was tragic, it was sad to see Polish gliders landed, and even Boer German half-tracks beginning to shoot them all up. And the Poles were utterly confused, some firing at Germans, some firing at us.
Once he was on the ground, Sosabowski was quick to get into the fray, deploying his surviving 500 Polish men to the immediate south of the Lower Rhine at Drill. Immediately, the Germans responded by placing 2,500 men between Sosabowski's troops and the British position, which meant that the Poles would have to cross the river to give support to Erkut in the pocket at Oesterbeek. On Friday the 22nd, 30 Corps made further efforts to get into Arnhem, but it was beaten back once more. Just one battalion of the 43rd Division, along with a small armored detachment of the Household Cavalry, was able to join up with the Poles. Erkut and his men remained hemmed in on three sides, and they too began to suffer as the casualties mounted and their supplies began to dwindle.
Oesterbeek just became surrounded by Germans, and you couldn't get north or south. We dug trenches, and every time we saw Germans, we shot at them. Simple as that.
The enemy was just here, and they stayed mostly here. And the next days, we tried, with the rest of our tanks, to fight against the British. And the main objective of our fighting was to keep the group of these British who were here from traveling to Arnhem.
That night, on the banks of the Lower Rhine, the Poles attempted to cross the river in small rubber boats in a brave mission of support for their British allies. Frustrated for so long, they showed enormous courage as they took to the water in the full face of withering German fire. Of approximately 50 men who made the crossing, 35 made it to the British positions on the north side. Alan Makovac was there to help his comrades clamber up the riverbank.
Our soldiers had to get in and also row across the quite wide river here, as it is, we know, with the very sharp, of course, of current as well. So it was, and during night, because in daylight, no chance. Everybody was just, you see, no chance at all. In fact, some soldiers were swimming because there was no room on the few boats which they delivered for us. And then you are just swimming across. Some got there, but some they were drenched like rats, of course, when they came out the other side.
The following day, Saturday the 23rd, the Dorset Regiment tried to cross the river. They lost many men, although a second Polish crossing that night did get 200 troops safely to the other side. By Sunday the 24th of September, however, with Urquhart's men cut down to less than 2,000 in number and out of ammunition, food and water, it was clear that the battle at Oosterbeek was lost. There was now no other alternative. Market Garden had failed, and the only course of action was to rescue as many as possible of the brave men who had fought so hard.
It did well to last 9 days, but had to go in the end.
The breakout didn't come soon enough for Alan Makovac. On his way to British headquarters at the Hartenstein Hotel, the Germans captured him.
When I was only about 150 yards from the headquarters, I noticed three faces with German helmets on and a machine gun pointed at me and calling, "Handy ho!" So, of course, I just had to consider, shall I raise my hands? And I suddenly, because I had a revolver, and so, but I felt that if I would move my hand in the wrong direction, they would just cut me in half from the machine gun. So I raised my hands, of course, and that was it.
And so on the evening of Monday the 25th of September, the escape from Arnhem, codenamed Operation Berlin, began.
We got instructions that we're going to retreat and go back across the river. And then we were told to spread out and wait for the boats to come in that would take us across the river. Quite a few lads actually swam across that river, 600 yards. That took some doing.
Got down to the river and managed to be lucky and swim across with another Royal Signals officer of the Light Regiment. We swam together and they were firing at us and he got hit and drowned. His body was picked up about 3 or 4 miles downriver later on, and I was lucky and got across.
I got across the river quite reasonably. We were bombed with mortar bombs all the time we were crossing. One or two landed quite close, and in dodging them, we naturally, doing that, bending down when we heard one come down, they lost the paddles. Anyway, we had our rifles, so we paddled across with our rifles.
The desperate need for a speedy Allied retreat meant that the badly wounded had to be left behind as the German panzers rolled towards the river. But it succeeded in its objective. 2,163 men were rescued. Among them, the exhausted General Urquhart. On the 26th of September, Siegfried Geiser reached the church at Oosterbeek, which was by now a makeshift hospital for the surrendered Allied troops.
This church of Oosterbeek was for me actually the end of the Battle of Arnhem. In the morning I came with another comrade of mine. We were two officers. We arrived at this church, and there we found in the church some British soldiers. Most of them were wounded. And I remember it was a very strange situation, because after 9 days of heavy fight, it was a very silent morning, no shooting anymore. So this silence of this morning, I never will forget. My feeling was to be very happy to still be alive.
Operation Market Garden had been a disaster. Of the 10,000 men who had seen action, 1,200 British and Polish troops had lost their lives. American losses approached some 4,000 dead, wounded, or captured. Despite the terrible bloodshed, the city of Arnhem remained in German hands, and the war would continue well into 1945. Those who lived through the hell would never forget it.
Whenever I'm in the area of Arnhem, I used to come to this place here and to have a look. And this affects me much more.
And it is when he breaks down, I have sometimes tendency as well in this respect, but you see, you don't sort of break down because you are disappointed or you are depressed. You are sort of crying with happiness, from happiness, that you are still here.